Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship. I'm Pastor Ella Molman, and Pastor Norm Anderson could not be here this morning. He's with his family, and his son is in the hospital. So we ask for your prayers for Tim and Norm's family as they provide care for his son and figure out what's going on and what's next for them. So we ask for your prayers, but we also have God providing us a preacher. So my husband, Lewis, will be giving us the sermon today and assisting me in worship. So maybe we need an extra prayer for that too.
I'm just going to use this. Oh, sound check. This is fun.
Yep, that works.
Now the question is, where do I clip it so you can hear me? How's that?
That's good.
Are we still good? Yep, we're still good.
All right. You have announcements in your bulletin, but I just wanted to draw your attention to two things. The first is that this is finally the week of our rummage sale. So bring your items to church starting Monday. The ladies are going to be setting up. The sale will take place Thursday and Friday afternoons. And I believe they still need some help taking whatever's left over and packing it up on Saturday. And if you can't find what you're looking for at our rummage sale on Thursday and Friday, on Sunday, our friends over at Englevale at Good Shepherd are doing a craft and bake sale, I believe. So you can go over there Sunday afternoon and find something there as well. And this is also the week that is our deadline to sign up for the youth mission trip this summer. So if you're 8th through 12th grade and want to join us on a mission trip to Nashville, get your forms into the church office this week. And with that, we will stand as we begin our worship together. The peace of Christ be with you always. And we take a moment to share a social distance sign of peace with a wave or a peace sign. And don't forget to wave at our friends at home on the live stream. Peace be with you. Peace. And we continue with our gathering song.
Thank you.
God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning, your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word, you created the world, calling forth life and mission. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection. By the grace of Christ among us, enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
I'd like to invite our children forward, and if you brought seeds for the blessing of the seeds, you can go on ahead and come forward as well. Just take a seat right there. Have a bunch of seeds up here, and we're going to give them a blessing. But first, I'm going to read you a little Bible story about seeds. On the third day, God said, "Let there be water and dry land." Drip, drop, kerplunk. There was water. Crackle, crunch, snap. There was dry land. God saw what the water and the land, and he saw that they were good. Then God said, "Let there be plants and trees." Rumble, rustle, pop. There were plants and trees. God saw that the plants and the trees were good. And there you can see all the plants and trees. And plants and trees have seeds, and they come from seeds, and the little seeds grow. And God says that the seeds are good too. So God makes the land, the sun, and the water, all the things that seeds need to grow into plants and trees that we eat for food. So today we're going to praise God who plants the seeds and brings in the harvest. Blessed be God forever. Say that with me. Blessed be God forever. Today we're going to ask God for blessing on the seeds we have up here and the crops that they will produce. Christ reminds us that unless a seed is planted in the ground and dies, then it will not grow fruit. As these seeds grow and are cared for by our farmers and gardeners, we ask that they be signs of new life from God. So let us pray together. Lord of planting and harvest, give us life. We ask God to listen. Repeat after me. Hear us, O Lord. Hear us, O Lord. When we get sad and angry from too much water and rain, save us, O Lord. Save us, O Lord. When we're wasteful because we have more than enough, save us, O Lord. Save us, O Lord. When we forget about other people who don't have enough, save us, O Lord. Save us, O Lord. And when we don't see you, God, in our work, save us, O Lord. Save us, O Lord. Amen. Now the adults are going to help me read the blessing. It'll be on the slide. And I need all of you to raise your hand up in blessing over the seeds. So can you help me put your hand up over the seeds? All right. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, we bless you and give you glory. You placed these gifts of creation into our hands, and you called us to work the earth and make it fruitful. Bless the soil in the fields that we work and make it ready to grow the seeds that we plant. Bless the seeds and help them to germinate and provide a good harvest so that they give food and work for many people. Give us each reminders of the care and presence and work. Protect the land from wind and hail and grant us good weather throughout this growing season. Just grateful for all your gifts. Nourish us, care for us, direct us in this season and in all the seasons ahead. Amen. And now, as you go back to your seats, you can bring some seeds with you. I've got marigold seeds here. And the name of these bright yellow flowers, marigolds, comes from two words, Mary's gold. So it's named after Mary, the mother of Jesus. So come on up and grab some seeds to take back. Here's the marigolds. And your parents can help you plant them. There's instructions there, too, if you need help. We continue with our readings.
Good morning. Our first reading is from Acts chapter 3, verses 12 through 19. Peter addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his God, in his name, his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through. Jesus has given him the perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read our psalm responsively, Psalm 4. Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I was in distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. You mortals, how long will you dishonor my glory? How long will you love illusions and seek after lies? Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. The Lord will hear me when I call. Tremble then and do not sin. Speak to your heart in silence upon your bed. Offer the appointed sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. Many are saying, "Who will show us any good? Let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord." You have put gladness in my heart, more than when grain and wine abound. In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, make me rest secure. Our second reading comes from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scripture. Then he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sin is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are a witness to these things." The Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Well, dear Christian friends, when Pastor Norm is out and with Pastor Ella having preached last week, I'm sorry, but you get stuck with me. And last week from Pastor Ella, we heard of the account of Jesus appearing to the disciples as told by St. John. Was that John? Did I say John? Today is Luke, isn't it? The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. But last week we heard from St. John about Jesus appearing to the disciples, and that's where we learned that one particular disciple gets a certain nickname. That's the disciple Thomas, the doubter, doubting Thomas, the one who doubts, filled with doubts. And to be completely fair, I believe that Thomas gets a bad rap. Why? Well, for one, can we really blame Thomas for doubting? Imagine with me, if you will, you're one of the disciples, or maybe you're not one of the disciples, but you're one of the people who happened to be living around the neighborhood where Jesus was, and you were aware of this guy who performed miracles, and maybe you remember there was this guy named Lazarus. Lazarus was dead for 4 days, a dear friend of Jesus. That's where Jesus stands at the tomb of Lazarus and says, "Lazarus, come out." For all the disciples knew, and actually for all I know too, Lazarus was the first person who was raised from the dead. And for Jesus to have then died on the cross meant that the only person who can raise people from the dead is himself dead. So with that in mind, I'm not a representative of St. Thomas, but if you could we go easy on this whole doubting thing? Luke, not John, in his account, isn't so easy on the 11 disciples. To set the stage for you, this is a section of the Gospel of Luke in the middle of the 24th chapter. And where we find this, I'm just going to give a brief recap. So we're just going to take, because it was 36 on, so we'll just look at 35, the first 35 verses. So in Luke 24, the first part, we have the women who have gone to a tomb, an empty tomb. And they've now gone back and told the disciples. And the only disciple, Peter, then runs to the tomb and he sees that the tomb, the stone has been rolled away, and that there are linens, the burial cloths that have been folded. And then Peter goes away amazed. But he doesn't seem to have told the other disciples what he's seen. Further along in that section, we get the story of the two disciples on their way to Emmaus, the Emmaus Road story. Jesus is in their presence, but they don't see him. At least they don't see him then. As he then asks them what's happened in Jerusalem, because they're looking sad. They tell him all of the things that have happened, and then as they're departing and splitting ways, they say, weary traveler, won't you come and join us for the evening? Won't you come and have an evening meal with us? And then it's only then when Jesus takes the bread, gives thanks, breaks it, and gives it to them to eat, do they then realize that they've been in the presence of Christ. And so that's where today's reading sits. Jesus has finally made his way as far as appearances go. He's now made his way to the rest of the disciples. And Jesus then stands among them. And in some translations, it says Jesus appeared among them. Just out of thin air, Jesus, poof, there he is. Why doesn't Jesus just knock on the door like a normal person would? And at this point in the disciples' lives, you have to understand. You have to understand that they were terrified of the world outside of where they are. They're terrified of what's outside of those locked doors. Maybe, just maybe, what's happened to Jesus might happen to me. Keeping a low profile is a way of survival for them. And then maybe after things settle down, they might be able to go back to living normal lives. James and John might go back and fish with their father. And maybe they can just chalk the last 3 or 4 years that they've spent with Jesus as a phase of life that they were going through. I mean, let's be honest, folks. Would you have answered the door if Jesus knocked? I mean, I don't even answer the door for the UPS guy. And half the time, I'm expecting him. So Jesus appears to them and says, peace be with you. And if you read between the lines, the disciples don't say anything. And we know that the disciples weren't Lutheran because peace be with you and also with you. So why the silence? Well, I mean, not only is it absolutely terrifying to have Jesus appear in your room, but it's also absolutely terrifying to have Jesus appear in your room, and it's unbelievable. In verse 38, Jesus is clearly aware of the doubts that have now appeared in the hearts of the disciples, and he invites the disciples then to look at his hands and his feet, and he says, do ghosts have skin and bones? Well, Jesus, to be fair, when I see a ghost, I'm not spending much time looking to see if they have the correct anatomical features of the living. And while I can stand here and tell you that if the Son of God were to appear before me, that if the Son of God were to knock at my door, that I would be brave and bold and answer, I'd be terrified. I'd be terrified and scared. But we know from the words of the disciples that's not what happened. We're told by Luke that the disciples' hearts are filled with joy. I don't know, maybe that's the response that we have when we're met face to face with the power of the life experience with the risen Christ. Isn't that what happens when we see God in the world around us, that our hearts are filled with joy? This is the freedom and the joy that we experience when we come face to face with the power of faith, that we're so overcome by joy that the seemingly impossible is not just possible, but it's a reality. And I know some of you are doubting about that. Imagine with me, if you will. I want you to look back over your last year. And if it helps, just look back over the last year that you've had together as a congregation. You've navigated a pandemic. You've worked yourself through a call process. You had a great success at the Buffalo Supper, fed all of the veterans. You've broadened your ministry goals and expanded your horizons to spread and share the good news of Jesus Christ in new and exciting ways. You have been in the presence of the living Lord. Have you taken the time to see him lately? We'll go to the next slide. I snuck in a slide there, and there is another slide. We are Trinity Lutheran, after all, so it makes sense that I might show a picture of Martin Luther. And as Martin Luther writes in his work on freedoms of a Christian, he says this: a person who has not tasted the spirit of faith in the midst of trials and misfortune cannot possibly write well about faith or understand what has been written about it. But for anyone who has had even a small taste of faith can never write, speak, reflect, or hear enough about it. If you were in confirmation, I'd ask you that Lutheran question: what does this mean? But it's Sunday morning and we've got a little time crunch, so I'll tell you what this means. What this means is that when we have experienced faith, that raw, earthy, in-your-face faith, we know that in the depths of our heart, that is where Christ is meeting us. In my last congregation that I served, I've seen the power of this faith overcome doubts. I've been at the side of the dying who, upon my arrival, are not ready for that next great adventure that they are going to embark on, the next season of their life. I remember one particular woman whose family was gathered around her. And as I entered the living room of the home where she was, she looked at me and she said, "I'm not ready. I'm not ready to go." And we prayed and we visited, and with her family, we celebrated her life. But most importantly, we recalled her faith, our faith. And I can remember as we said the Lord's Prayer, she grabbed my hand and she held it. And she looked at me and she said, "I'm ready now." That's our faith. That's our Lutheran faith. Yours and mine, our faith has the power to do this. Our theology has this wonderful ability to secure us when we have doubts. Even on our best days, Pastor Ella and I still have our doubts. And doubting is a part of our faith journey, and it isn't something that we should be ashamed of. I mean, after all, the disciples had doubts. They were with Jesus his whole ministry. They saw Jesus in the flesh and blood, and they still had their doubts. So we can doubt too. How could you not doubt? I mean, it seems like anytime you turn on the TV, you just see news story after news story about mass shootings, about violence, about big cities, about protesting and riots. The cycle just seems to start over, and we just ask God, "Where are you? Can you please just make it stop?" Our world and our lives can cause us to doubt. But I'm asking you that you don't let doubt be the last step. We don't just get to doubt and say, "Okay, that's it. I get to wash my hands of this. I get to throw in the towel." Doubting is a step in the process. And Jesus, in today's gospel story, reminds us what we should do when we aren't sure, when those doubts arise. What does Jesus do when he doubts? What does Jesus do for the disciples when they doubt? He eats with them. Jesus eats with them. He invites to the table and says, here is me. Put your hands in my feet and in my sides. And in a few minutes, Ella and I are going to invite you forward for communion. And you're going to come forward and you're going to receive those elements in your hand. a tangible explanation, hopefully, to satisfy those doubts. This area up here that kind of goes across has some steps leading up to it. And the fancy word for this area is the chancel area. And it's not just designed this way so that you all have a better view of what's going on up here, but it's also built and designed with a particular theology in mind. It's to say that these are the steps that lead us towards heaven, and that at the same time, heaven is reaching down to meet us here. It's a promise that wherever you are in your faith journey, when you come forward, that Jesus is there to meet you, inviting you to taste the freedom that we receive from a God who loves us and redeems us. Friends, I'm not promising that this faith journey is going to be an easy one. Wherever you are in your faith process, because believe me, it can be tough. Following Jesus is filled with doubts and it's challenging. But what I am asking you to do is that you continue to look for the resurrected Christ, living, breathing, walking, appearing among us. A Christ that is asking you, daring you, challenging you into a life filled with joy. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. One more time with some gusto. Christ is risen. I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing our hymn of the day. The whole church on earth, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church. Alive in the risen Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Living God, in the midst of this Easter joy, we are filled with questions and wondering. Open our hearts and minds as we encounter the scriptures so that the church embodies repentance and forgiveness in the name of Jesus to all nations. Hear us, O God. God of all, like a master artist, you have fashioned the universe out of your love and delight. Heal your creation where it is in need of restoration. The nations hunger and thirst for your righteousness. Many call on you for guidance and strength. Answer their hopes with the peace of Christ and give your loving kindness to nations, states, and local leaders. Hear us, O God. Healing God, your heart, and you hear the cries of those in need and answer them in their distress. Grant to those who are sick and suffering your compassion and nurse them back to health and wholeness. Be close to the hearts of the lonely. Hear us, O God. In hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now we'd like to take a moment to offer our gifts up to God. We give of ourselves, we offer our seeds, our time, our possessions, and all to Christ with joy and thanksgiving. Let us sing. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. You all may be seated, and the ushers will invite you forward when it's time for you to come up for communion.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's resurrection, you send light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of life to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to your Son's resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you.
Be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you mercy. Amen.
We join in our sending song.